developer in Postgres Pro company, and I'm more famous at optimizing things in PostgreSQL. And this is my colleague, Anastasia. She's mostly interested in indexes and data structures, stuff like this. And in this talk, we would like to tell you a few things about compression in PostgreSQL.
I'm pretty sure that everyone here understands the importance of database compression. We want to store more and more data every day. So in this talk, I'll try to explain in a nutshell, first of all, how Postgres stores your data. Then we'll list a number of things you can check in the database schema to ensure that it acts optimally. There's a lot of tricks. Then we'll introduce a new mechanism of page level compression, which is a feature of Postgres Pro Enterprise Edition. It's a fork supported by our company. And finally, Alexander will present the extension for JSONB compression, which is open source and totally free. The compression is a too big subject to cover in just 1 hour talk, so there is a list of things we won't discuss in details, but they are still worth mentioning. First of all, MVCC copies. You can find a lot of great talks and articles about auto vacuum tuning, about MVCC. I think that the next talk will be devoted to this topic. Another thing to know is that Postgres catalog also can be bloated. For example, if you use a lot of temporary tables or actively change schema in some other way, there will be a lot of copies in your catalog table. One log can also take a lot of space, but it's a kind of derivative of your data. Less data you have, less will be the more log size. Only if you are not one of those risky guys who don't care about data safety and use unlocked tables. In some situations they can be really useful, but unsafe. And since 9.5, there is an option to enable wall compression. Surprisingly, there are still many people who are not familiar with it. Please check it in the documentation. And also, you can use file systems that support compression, but that's their topic for this one. Okay, let's look how Postgres stores data. It has role-oriented storage. Physical representation of the role is called tuple. Tuple consists of the header and attributes. Tuples are placed as pages, which in their turn form the files. That is the format for all tables, indexes, and materialized views, which exist in Postgres. So it's clear that meta information takes some space, but how much exactly? Maybe it's not that dramatic. Let's estimate it. Imagine we have no data, except meta information. Fortunately, Postgres allows you to create a table without any attributes at all, just some meta information. Let's insert 10 million rows into the table and check the size. Any guesses how big it is?
Just out of curiosity, who thinks that it will be about the zero? Please raise your hands. Mm-hmm. And who thinks it will be less than, say, 100 megabytes? Anyone who thinks it will be more than 100 megabytes?
Okay, so it's not even close to be empty. It takes 268 megabytes of disk space. So, of course, it's just a synthetic example and has nothing to do with real databases. But still, I think it's good to keep in mind that meta information is not cheap. It's not free. Let's look what exactly takes this space. Using page inspect extension, we can look at hidden meta fields. There is info to support transactions, a couple of infomasks, data length, and other valuable information that takes 24 bytes per row. It seems to be excessive for some workloads, but database is not only about storing data, it's about providing fast and optimal access to it. So all this stuff is actually necessary for
Okay, another thing, one thing that is good to know when you are interested in making small tables is alignment of the data. As you might know, integer and boolean, for instance, they consume different amount of disk space, and data in PostgreSQL is aligned. How exactly it depends on the type. For instance, every integer is aligned on its address starts with its address could be divided by 4 in case of integer, and it is divided by 8 in case of big integer. And as this slide shows, well, just changing the order of attributes in our table, we can save some disk space, just because otherwise it will be consumed by a line.
Question? Is this because Postgres data types are native?
I'm sorry?
Is this because Postgres data types are native? That's why this kind of benefit you're getting?
It's because you see, big integer, it should be aligned. It should start with address which could be divided by 8. So if and 4 bytes, just white ones will just be not used if big int comes right after integer. So it's just how PostgreSQL works. And another interesting thing are nulls. In previous slides, Anastasia showed tuples, and tuples they have a header, and the size of header is 83 bytes to be exact. But it's also, well, data after the header is also aligned. This is why tuple header actually used 24 bytes of disk space. But right after the tuple header, there is a bit mask that, it stores bits. This bit mask shows whether a corresponding tuple is null or not. If it's true, it's null. If it's false, it's not null. And this bit mask comes right after the header. And if you have 8 nulls or less, you see it comes header and bit mask right after it. And because of the alignment, it doesn't matter if you have these 8 nulls or not. It will be aligned to 84 bytes anyway. So you can have up to 8 nulls just for free. And naturally, if you have 9 nulls, it doesn't matter whether you have 9 nulls or 10 or 11, you will, 1 byte will be allocated anyway. So it's basically it.
One more story about alignment. All index entries, in order to access index tuple headers, also must be aligned to 8 bytes. This rule has one pretty non-intuitive conclusion. If you have an index of one integer column, if you have multiple indices of two integers, or you have one big integer index, they all have the same size. So probably you shouldn't be afraid of big integers, and probably you shouldn't be afraid of multiple indices too. And that's a place where another feature of PostgreSQL may come in handy, such called covering indexes. So if your index cannot be smaller, for example, its index, its primary key on one integer field, it probably can keep more data. Covering index allow you to add any non-key column to the primary key index. So it's just another instrument to build better schema. As any other instrument, it has its cons. So for example, as any other index, it's not very optimal for heavy write load or a lot of updates, so use it wisely. And now it's available in our fork called Postgres Pro, and hopefully it will be available in Postgres 9. I hope.
this example on the slide is actually a real world story. We helped one of our customers to migrate to PostgreSQL from some other database management system, and turned out that after migration, database become much bigger than it used to be, and our investigation showed that it's because in this database were used the UUIDs, and after migrating, there were stored in byte A data type, which is not the best idea for storing UUIDs. And by using a special data type for UUIDs, we can significantly decrease database size. And the same applies for various other data types. For instance, there is a MacAdder data type and some other. Here is another funny thing. There are different types in PostgreSQL for storing time and days and that timestamps. Recently I discovered that type which is called time TZ, it is stored the following way. The 64-bit integer is used to store a timestamp, and another 32-bit integer is used to store a time zone. It's quite a lot of disk space to store just the time. There is another type, timestamp with a time zone, which is just a 64-bit integer. It's not intuitive that timestamp, which is time plus date, it uses less space than just the time, but it's how PostgreSQL works. If you're interested, you can check it. Just create a table with one column with type timestamp TZ, insert some data which is different time zones, and then select it. You will see that the time zone is changed. PostgreSQL will use your time zone, but it's just not stored in the database. PostgreSQL has Toast. It's a mechanism which, basically it splits your data in small chunks, because as was shown on previous slides, there are pages, and page size is limited. It's 8 kilobytes by default. And what to do if your data is much larger, for instance, 1 gigabyte? In this case, if you host mechanism, which splits your data in chunks and stores these chunks in special host tables. And the reason why I'm talking about Toast right now is because it has a built-in compression called, the algorithm is called PGLD, which is more or less the same as the leap in terms of speed and ratio. It's, if I'm not mistaken, it's a bit slower and compressed a bit not as good as the leap, but it's more or less the same. How JLC determines whether your data should be compressed or not. For instance, if you are storing, I don't know, compressed images, it doesn't make much sense to compress it once more time. PostgreSQL tries to compress first kilobyte, if I'm not mistaken, first bytes of your data, if it compresses well, then it compresses it for all the data. If you have large streams, for instance, large data which is compressed well, you basically can do nothing and PostgreSQL will compress it for you. In case you are storing some binary data which is compressed not good in the beginning and compresses well in the end, you should consider reordering, so data which compresses good
One more thing to say about toast is that it's triggered only if your attribute is more than 2 kilobytes, if I'm not mistaken. So if you really have like a number of rows which are about 1 kilobyte in size, toast won't be triggered. That's why one more thing to do is probably pick data into arrays, into bigger chunks, to trigger toast. Of course, if it shows to your local. So, basically, what we want to say is that you should know your data and know your database in order to store it in optimal way. Of course, there are a lot more tricks than we have listed, and experienced DBAs should know them, but we think that life can be a little bit simpler, and that's why we suggest CFS. CFS is abbreviation for Compressed File System. It's a feature of Postgres Pro Enterprise Edition developed by our colleague, Konstantin Knyzhnik. And I think it's a good time to ask if anyone uses Postgres on Compressed File System.
Anyone?
Anyone.
And which file system?
ZFS.
Interesting. Yeah, it's worked well.
Mm-hmm.
So far,
about 2 times.
Well,
we mostly use it for OLAP loads, you know, data warehouse type of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as good for transactional systems, so of course, because there's write penalties. But for data warehouse, it works really well.
Okay, and guys, are you using FreeBSD or
yes?
Spots. In this case, on Debian, Ubuntu Linux.
Okay.
So somehow there was a number of proposals in PostgreSQL hackers, and the reason to reject them was why don't you run Postgres on compressed file system? I think we can do better. The main idea of CFS is to apply compression to the page when it's evicted from buffer cache to disk, and decompress when it's loaded to shared buffer cache. Since after compression pages have variable size, we need an additional level of mapping, which is implemented in CFM for copy relation. That's quite simple, as shown in the pictures. CFS always writes pages at the end of the file if they are changed. It allows to keep writes sequential and keep your reads actually sequential. And also it makes it possible to implement the extension of the file in lockless manner. In order to remove outdated pages, CFS has its own garbage collector. There is a set of background workers which read relation segment by segment, copy and leave pages to the new segment, and then with minimal locking switch them and remove all segment. Now compression can be applied at table space level, so if you want to use CFS, just create table space with compression enabled, and so it works. You can set these table spaces as default if you really want, and just operate tables as before. Except for one more level of garbage collection, there are background workers, and also they can be called manually, just like vacuum and empty vacuum. Let's look at the numbers. On PGBench test, data loading is about 2 times lower because that's heavy write load and it is expected result because each data must be compressed before writing it to the disk. What is much better and much more impressive, database size is 18 times smaller. In the next slide, I'll explain such unbelievable result. And usual data integration is 5% better in terms of TPS. I would say it's about the same, so no dramatic decrease, nothing absolutely unbelievable increase. So, now try synthetic benchmarks. We tested compression algorithms on a dataset generated by PGBench, and size reduction is extremely unbelievably big. The reason is that PGBench tables has a lot of long zeroed strings, and the column filler, as you can see, it contains
Well, we were told there is no microphone.
Well,
yeah, we need to. I'm sorry. Yeah, we do.
We can pass it.
Okay. Hopefully it works. The reason why database was compressed 18 times is that column filler, which is 84 bytes character, it contains not just empty string, but actually 84 zeros. So it can be compressed really well. The reason why I put this slide here is that you always should try any new feature on your data and decide whether it's used for your load. So we also compared various compression algorithms on the same dummy dataset, but it's the same for all algorithms, so it's okay to compare them. You can see results at the slide, and by the way, notice that Postgres internal compression algorithm is not that bad, but it can be improved. So I think that hackers can think a little bit about that. While it's easy to make compression algorithms pluggable, we decided to choose only one and leave just ZSD as default compression algorithm, as providing best compression ratio and acceptable speed. Some more benchmarks on real data. You can see that after applying compression, your usage significantly decreased. One more point to mention is that now Postgres uses double bufferization. It means that pages evicted from shared memory, they're not going straight to disk, but to operating system page cache. And in most cases, that is a disadvantage. But for CFS, it's happened to be a good thing. In some cases, compressed data can fit into operation system cache, and thus avoid a lot of costly disk operations. And also, we can look at CPU graph. There is no dramatic CPU overhead for compression, which is quite good. Numbers are about the same as before. Because each page will be decompressed only once when it loaded to buffer cache, and that's not that often. Just like any other approach, CFS has its advantages and disadvantages. It provides good compression ratio because all information on the page is compressed, not including metadata, including some empty spaces. It provides better locality because pages are always written sequentially. What is good, it's not that hard to support because it requires minimal changes in PostgreSQL core. We have tried a couple of different solutions. Like we tried to compress each tuple, we tried dictionary compression, but it seems to be too difficult to support. And also it provides flexibility. It's easy to use various compression algorithms, why for now we use only ZSD. Of course, CFS has some limitations. Buffer cache pages are not compressed, which is not actually a problem. It's just how it works, because there is no CPU overhead for cached data. Next issue is wall and replication. Now it's not optimized at all. Replica has to perform compression and garbage collection and all the things related to CFS on its own. And also one more level of mapping is one more level of fragmentation. So CFS needs its own garbage collector, which must be tuned. One more thing to worry about for DBA. But still, we think that's a good solution. So please, if you want to try it or discuss, I will be glad to answer questions at the end of the presentation.
Test. Okay, I would like to tell you about ZSON. It's an extension, PostgreSQL extension, which is open source and it's on GitHub. It works with vanilla PostgreSQL. Feel free to use or just try it. And basically, it compresses JSONB. And originally, it was developed for one of our customers and developers of this company. For some reason, they didn't want to think about how they represent their data. They just wanted to use JSONB and that it will be compact. So the idea is quite simple. Just let's take a JSONB, find strings in JSONB which are used frequently, and replace the strings to 16-bit codes using a dictionary. And I will not show a lot of benchmarks because, well, ZSON is not a silver bullet. You have to understand what you are doing. But in some cases, it improves performance. For instance, if your data is couldn't be stored entirely in memory, and you have to go to the disk all the time. In this case, ZSON works well. In case if all your data fits into the memory, it doesn't work well because data is stored in memory compressed as well, and ZSON just decompresses it all the time. So just you have to understand what you are doing. So let's take a look on how JSONB looks like on the disk. It's a segment of the table. You can see that there are a lot of strings that are repeated all the time. If JSON documents are similar, for instance, there are similar keys in each document. There are also a lot of zeros, which seems like something that could be compressed well. So here are the problems: redundancy, usage of disk space, usage of memory, and as a result, there is input and output, disk input and output are not great, and we have less transactions per second comparing with what we could have. So actually, there were like three implementations of ZSON before we found an approach that actually works. And I will not tell you all the details right now. You can ask me later in the hall. But here is how ZSON works now. It creates a dictionary of strings. Replaces strings in original documents to 16-bit codes, and after that data is compressed using PGLZ as usual. So, well, it probably will not work worse than it used to be before, right? Before using ZSON, you have to learn it on your common data. You can use JSON learn procedure for this purpose. It's quite simple. You just give names of tables and columns, and it looks on your data and create a dictionary. You can call it a core of how JSON learns of your data. It's not that complicated. Basically, it finds all the strings in documents. By all strings, I mean keys, values, array elements, etc. All the strings. Here is how ZSON works. I mean, JSONB can be implicitly converted to ZSON and vice versa, and that means you can use all the usual operators. Everything that works with JSONB works with ZSON as well. ZSON is just a wrapper which compresses and decompresses data. It makes nothing more. Here is how data is compressed data is stored on disk. There is one byte for ZSON version in case ZSON implementation will be changed somehow in the future. Then comes one integer with version of the dictionary because the ZSON supports multiple versions of dictionary. You can relearn the ZSON when your data changes. Size of the original data, and then comes so-called hint. It's just a sequence of zeros which it needed for PGLZ to show that, hey, look, this data compresses well. You should probably try to compress it. And by default, it's, if I'm not mistaken, it's 32 bytes. But you can safely change it in the code. If you define PGLZ hint size as zero, it will work as well. And yes, as I told you, I will not show any benchmarks because it's very it depends on your data, but we did some tests on data that our clients had, and in this case we gained like 10% more transactions per second. And on GitHub you can find a benchmark which describes it in more detail, but it's basically it. If you have any questions, we will be happy to answer it, please.
Is it an extension or a
core? ZSON is an extension. It's not in contrib, it's not in core currently, at least. But it's a usual PostgreSQL extension. You can download it, say make install, then create extension, and it just works. Please.
Is the page compression, is that done entirely in
Yes, it's implemented mostly on this layer. There's some more stuff required for garbage collection system because it requires some locking and other things. But mostly it's in SMJR and MD layer. Yeah.
So in regards to the page compression, so your comment about it was essentially that we can do better than file system encryption like ZFS or or whatever. So, what are the advantages of doing it this way specifically?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
What to do the compression in
what is the advantage?
Rather than on at the file system level, what's the specific advantage?
I don't know. Actually, for some reasons, not all of our DBAs in our company, not all of them are trusted to compressed file systems. Maybe because none of them familiar with them, maybe for some other reasons, but somehow not many DBAs want to use them.
Okay.
That's why we decided to implement it in the Postgres.
Actually, as I see it, just customer has Linux and X4 on it, and the customer doesn't want to migrate somewhere. He just wants to my data should be compressed. That's all.
I have a couple of questions. Do you actually have any benchmarks of CFS versus, say, ZFS, either on Linux or FreeBSD or anything like that? And my other question is about the JSON stuff. Where is the dictionary stored?
Okay, I can answer on the question regarding JSON. It stores a dictionary in regular table. It's called JSON dict. And it's quite similar. It's like dict ID, word ID, and the word. It's just three columns. Nothing special. And it's cached in memory. It's a bit more complicated, but it basically it's a search tree in the memory. No, JSON uses only most frequently used strings. You can specify how many and add strings after learning. So By default, it uses at most 64 thousands of strings, because codes are 60-bit integers.
Okay, regarding CFS benchmarks, we haven't, we didn't them, but I think it's a good idea to do, to have some something to compare with. Tests on real data, on various data, shows compression for about five times, up to five times. On some cases, it's more if the data is can be compressed well, if there are some JSONs, if there are some frequently repeated fields. And sometimes it's about three times if data is normalized and not that well compressed.
Yeah. If you add page-based compression, you add a record to a page that makes it larger, how's that handled?
If something on the page was changed, the page will be compressed once again and written into the end of the file.
Okay.
So there is just sequential writing, and outdated page will be evicted by garbage collection afterward.
Then none of the pages will be written back to? None of the ones that existed?
Yes.
Okay, it's append only?
Append only.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it doesn't work really well on heavy update workload, but for example, archive tables, it provides really good results. So, any other questions? Thank you for attention.